Hey, it's Fran, again, and in my slightly filthy lab, I've been working on a new project that I thought that I would do a vlog about, and this little vlog is going to be about diode steering, and all the fun that you can have with just using a simple, ordinary diode. I got inspired to do this about a month ago. Dave Jones on the EEV blog, he did his mailbag, and all of you, I'm sure, subscribe to EEV blog just like I do, and everyone loves the mailbag, but he got a kit, or I guess it was an assembled kit, from Colin Mitchell, who has this amazing site. If it's not in your bookmarks, it should be, and I'll put a link down in the description where you can go and take a look at Colin Mitchell's online book, really. He's got this just massive website, and with a particular big page about the 555 timer. And the 555 is so ubiquitous and so, like, you know, such a standard in electronics. You could almost think that the benchmarks in solid-state electronics were the invention of the transistor, and then the invention of the integrated circuit, and then the invention of the 555. It almost is that fundamental a milestone. But there's Colin Mitchell has a great page on the 555 with lots of projects you can do and descriptions of how the 555 works with little animations. You can see how the capacitor charges and discharges and how the timer works. And they've got a little calculation computer, a little table where you can put in the values or get the values out depending on the kind of timing that you want for the timer. It's got everything. So anyway, go there, you'll have fun. But the kit that Dave got was Colin's 555-4017 scanner kit, and I really like the way he did it with the headers, and you could snap in all these different little displays and have it do different things. And as Dave mentioned, that, well, you know, when you put in the scanner, it works with diode steering. And I thought, well, you know, no one really talks about diode steering, or it's kind of like put in, well, it's something you can do, whatever. But I wanted to do a vlog showing you really the possibilities for diode steering and how relevant it is, even today. See, these days, especially beginning hobbyists, they sort of see the brass ring as being having a microcontroller blink an LED or operate a display with some kind of an Arduino or a similar little microcontroller. But you know, you don't have to go the microcontroller route to really do some complicated displays. You can build very sophisticated controls for displays simply using diode steering. So to start this whole project, I did a copy or my own version of that 555-4017 setup, which is a very old kind of design. It goes back to when I was a kid, you know, when these display chips started coming out for LED bar display drivers and LED 7-segment drivers and LED, you know, all these different chips that were going to allow you to create different displays. They became very popular, and people started very early figuring out how you could really make these chips do different things. And the 4017 is a very ubiquitous chip for this, because it's a CMOS chip. For the 4017B is CMOS. It's got 10 outputs, and it's usually used as a decade counter, because all you have to do is provide it with a clock pulse, and it will go from one output to the next and only one of the 10 outputs will have a high signal at any one time, which makes it ideal for doing projects that use diode steering. So this is my little schematic of my 555-4017. I actually did two different versions of this. I built it up on a breadboard with a header, just like the Colin Mitchell project, because I thought it really cool to be able to just quickly attach different outputs. It's pretty simple. I have a post of this I'll put on my blog, of the schematics, so you can do your own project. But I've marked all of the external components in red. There's only like five components you're going to need, you know, three resistors, two caps, and a 555 chip and a 4017B chip. That's really all you need to throw us together. And then, you know, the LEDs some 4148 diodes just to do various versions of this little kit. All right, so this is it. It's pretty straightforward. I put an LED in there just to show the pulse for the clock, just as a reference. And it's got the header on it. And this is just 10 LEDs and one resistor. The LEDs are set up to have a common cathode, such as just one current limiting resistor, and then only, you know, one LED at a time is on, so one resistor is fine. And I just snap that in here. So, zoom out a little bit. I gotta turn off some lights here. There we go. Get a little darker in the lab. Alright. I'm gonna put a 5-volt supply on this. There we go. It's pretty straightforward. Just counts 0 through 9 or 1 through 10. It's pretty arbitrary. If you look in the nomenclature, the first digit's always 0, but for the sake of this experiment, I've, you know, used the first one as 1 and then count to 0 just because I can, you know. I'm making my own rules, you know. It's my project. I'll make the rules. So you'll notice that when the clock LED, it's the leading edge of the high pulse that triggers the 4017 to go to the next position. And it's kind of curious because when I shot some video of this early on when I was testing, when I reviewed it, you could actually go through frames where both LEDs were off. So there is a delay in there where both LEDs will be off, which is kind of interesting too. Anyway, but this just shows the 4017 in action as a decade counter, and this is really the way that it's designed to work. Just 10 outputs, one output on at any one time, provide the clock pulse, and it goes from one to the next to the next. When it reaches the ninth position, it carries over and starts to the zero position again. And that's pretty much it. So, I'm going to turn it off. There we go. And plug in this board. This is another one I made. I'm going to zoom in on this here. There we go. Now this is the scanner board. And for this, I've used 6 LEDs instead of 10. And I've got 10 4148 signal diodes, silicon diodes. And the coolest thing about the scanner is really the animation. I'll show you here. Click it on. Zoom out. Put on some power. All right. See that? Look at that. Now it's reversing direction. Now you have to understand, I'm not doing anything to the 4017 chip. That's still behaving in the same way. But the display is animated to change direction. So how is that possible? Well, it's done with diode steering. And to show you the schematic again, and you see that I've got the 10 4148 diodes right here, one of them on each of the outputs from the 4017. And the first six just go right to the six LEDs. So you basically just have a diode that is just allowing the current to go to the LED, and then the LED will light up. But the last four outputs have diodes that steer that current back to different pins. So when I had the other board attached, you could see that the LEDs were turning on 1 through 10, or 0 through 9, however you want to label them, in a sequential manner. The same thing is happening here, but with diode steering, what's happening is you're getting a different sequence. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 1, 2, 3. And that's the sequence that's happening. The diodes are steering the current to the selected LED that I want to light up. So the sequence is the same. It's going 0 through 9, or 1 through 10. But when it gets to the seventh position, it begins to steer that current to a diode that is going in reverse direction. So you've got a display that is being changed just with diode steering. And I think this is really cool, but you know, it doesn't really show what you can really do with diode steering. So I thought, well, what about doing something really interesting? So I took this idea and thought I'd expand it to that. How about that? All right, so this is a little more of a grand experiment in diode steering. What I've done here is created a discrete, or a design for a discrete 7-segment display driver using diode steering. And it looks like this. This is what I built. And it's a little complex. It's got this 3-dimensional matrix on the back there, you can see, which is it's a little bit of a construction challenge, but this is the board. I put 10 LEDs up here so that you can actually see the digit that the 4017 is putting high, and then the corresponding 7-segment display to show you the number of that digit. But before I get into how I made this board and how it works, a little discussion about diodes. Diodes are not perfect. They're not perfectly efficient. And whenever you use a diode and put current through it, you're always going to have a loss in the voltage. It's the forward bias voltage drop. It's usually just called the diode drop. You're going to find that without a load, the diode's going to have a much lower drop in voltage than if it's under load. And of course, the more you load down a diode, then the more that drop is going to increase just because of the resistance in the system and all that. So whenever you use a diode steering, you're going to accumulate loss in voltage, especially if it's multi-layered. If you've got several layers of diodes, then with each layer of diode steering, you're going to also have a loss of voltage, which is why when they started using solid-state diodes for logic, that they employed transistors in a diode transistor logic arrangement, DTL, where the diodes actually do all the decision making and steer the current around, and then transistors are used for just inverters and buffers to increase the voltage where needed, and also to invert a signal where needed, is all the transistors used for. It's not really used for decision making in a DTL situation. And that's what I did for my little driver board here. It's basically pure DTL. But one of the things about diodes that you're going to find eventually, if you haven't already found it, is that a lot of schematic descriptions in electronics, it's backwards. Yes, Fran is going to employ the dry erase marker. But the symbol for a diode, right, it's actually backwards. Because the point of the arrow actually points against the flow of current. The cathode is actually the point that it's pointing to, and the anode is actually the back end. You're going to find this same reversed description in transistors, where like the arrow in an NPN transistor on the base is actually pointing against where the current's actually flowing. And this is a problem in schematics that goes back 100 years or more. The schematic representations of components, a lot of them predate the discovery of the electron, and all of the symbolism in electronic schematics is all based on early experiments in electricity, which is really based on what is sometimes called the Franklin model, after Benjamin Franklin's experiments in electricity, which dealt with static charges. And for so long, scientists really saw electricity as being a charge of electricity that would then be discharged to ground. And even today, it's used a lot, the description that the current wants to go to ground, the electrons want to go to ground, that they want to seek ground. But of course, the opposite is true. You know, that's where the electrons are. The currents go in the other direction. And so diodes are drawn backwards, just as a lot of symbols in electronics are drawn backwards. The currents actually flow in the opposite direction. So this is just one layer of confusion. So whenever you put in an LED and you're wondering, well, wait a second, why is it really supposed to go where the arrow points to ground? And so just think the opposite of what would be natural, and you'll get it right. But the diode drop is not the reason I put transistors in my 7-segment display driver. As you can see from this little guy running right now, can I zoom in here? The scanner works just fine without any transistors. And that's because the 4017 is designed to drive an LED, but just like one or two LEDs. In fact, if you look at the data sheet for the 4017B and see that the device dissipation per output transistor, that's for each output transistor that is the driving buffer for each of those 10 output stages, the maximum dissipation is 100 milliwatts per output. And before you go saying, oh wow, 100 milliwatts, well, you could drive like 20 LEDs with that. I said, no, hang on, it's not milliamps, it's milliwatts, 100 milliwatts. So, when you figure out power, it's as easy as pi, P-I-E. The power is equal to the current times the voltage. So 100 milliwatts, if you're running a 5-volt supply, it's 20 milliamps. So 20 milliamps is about the max, which is fine if you want to drive one or two or maybe even three LEDs if you want to stop down the current a bit. But a 7-segment display, 7 LEDs, probably not. And to add more to that, I decided for my project that I was going to use a super, super awesome vintage Monsanto MAN 72. Yep. That's it's decoded June 1976. One of the first large size 7-segment light piped displays. And before you think, oh geez, you've taken this, this very early display, you soldered it onto a board. Well, I did, because I am willing to wager that I have the single largest collection of MAN 72s on the planet. This box is full, absolutely full of MAN 72s. They're all day coded 1976. Yeah. Oh, I'll tell you. A box of 1976 seven segment diode. Makes the heart tingle. It really does. So. No worries on the rarity, because probably most, if not all, of the MAN 72s in the world are right here. But those of you who have seen my earlier vlog about the earliest LEDs, you would know that these early seven-segment LED displays didn't use just one LED or two LEDs. They had strings of LED dyes in there because the dyes were so dim that you, in order to illuminate a light pipe to the size of a segment, like the size of the MAN 72, you would need a string of LED dyes. And there are four dyes in each of these segments, as near as I can calculate, because the MAN 72, just with a nominal brightness, like a very average kind of medium dim brightness, will pull about 17 milliamps per segment, which means that there's probably about four dyes in there, and they're dim dyes at that. So with 17 milliamps per segment, well, the number 8, that's going to cost you about 120 mils. So that's a lot of current, and it's way over the capacity of the output of our little 4017. And also there's a great deal of difference in the load between displaying a number 1 and a number 8. So the transistors are here in typical DTL fashion to act as the drivers. Another interesting thing about these 7-segment displays, especially the early ones for TTL and early CMOS, is that the early ones, they tend to be common anode displays. The reason is that they knew that you would have to run the display with transistors as drivers, and the transistors would automatically act as inverters if you just use one. So and the standard being with the CMOS and the TTL stuff that when the bit is on, it's high. It's at the V plus. So in putting a transistor in there with a common anode display meant that you could do a single transistor with a current limiting resistor to the display segment, and a high signal on the base of that transistor would make it turn on, it would conduct current, and the segment would turn on. So the common anode 7-segment display is very typical for the era when it was expected that you'd use transistors to actually do the driving on your display. So all that is why I have this transistor stage on my discrete 7-segment diode steering encoder. And that's another thing that people who are on my Twitter feed got an advanced look at this, and there was a little bit of discussion about what it is. And it is arguable whether you'd want to call this an encoder or a decoder. I guess it really depends on your definition of what's being encoded or what's being decoded, because it's really converting a single bit into a complex numerical set. So it could be argued that it's actually an encoder that's actually encoding the numeral out of a single bit, or it could be argued that it's a decoder decoding a single bit into a number that you can understand. But I guess you could argue it either way. I think it's probably more of an encoder, but you know, whatever you want to call it, it's definitely a converter of going from one bit to a numeral. So let's attach this board and see it work. Okay, I'm gonna detach the header. I really like this design with the detachable header. It was a really creative thing that Colin Mitchell did. I really like that. I'm gonna use this a lot more. But I built this with the same header. I had to add an extra wire because I do need a V plus in addition to the signal. All right. So, in addition to the vintage MAN 72 7-segment display, I'm also using some vintage late 60s NPN bipolar transistors to do the driving. These little guys here, these are made by RCA, the RCA 29706, which you can look up at your leisure, but it's basically just your run-of-the-mill early silicon NPN bipolar transistor. It's got a beta around 30. It's listed as a beta around 30, but I actually tested a few of these in my tester, and they're actually running around 31, 32 on the beta. So, you know, I got some turbocharged silicon transistors, so pretty cool. And because of the high current nature of the MAN 72, I'm actually running about 200 ohms on the current limiting resistors. For your version of this, you're going to have to choose a correct value for the display. If you're running a modern display, something with high efficiency, you're going to be running values up, you know, 470 or higher to get the current down. But this hefty MAN 72, I'm running a pretty low current limiter. And what I've done here is, I have to pull this off here. The diodes are set up in a matrix so that every column is a digit and every row is a segment. And the intersections of the two are where you put your various diodes to steer the current to that the appropriate segments based on the digit that's turning on. Like I said, I've put these 10 LEDs up here. It's not on the schematic, but it's just to show the digit that's on in relation to the number that's being displayed. But you can see the pattern in the columns for the various numbers. I've labeled them in the traditional way, A through G, with the segments starting with the upper segment being A, going clockwise around to F, and then the center segment being G, and that's how I've labeled them from top to bottom. And again, that's the reason for this complicated three-dimensional matrix, because I've got segments going horizontally and I've got digits going vertically, you see. So that's the matrix, the real matrix. See that? Okay. And put some fire to the wire. There you go. The great thing about doing this is that you can customize the display. So what I've done here is sometimes the 9 is represented with a little tail on the bottom, but I didn't do that on mine because, you know, my prerogative. You can do it however you want. And again, I made mine count from 1 to 0, which some people will probably take offense to, that you should start with 0 and end with 9, but hey, I'm making the rules. It's mine. So I start with 1. We can see the LEDs up here that are coming on showing the digits that are being activated by the 4017. That's the actual 4017 output on the top there. And then the number is being displayed based on the diode steering. And then just the transistors are just acting as the drivers for the individual segments. And this is pretty much everything that would be inside of a 7-segment decoder driver or encoder driver that you would buy. So there you go. This is showing the potential of the complexity of what you can produce just with steering diodes. And you can translate this to just about any kind of display if you're doing a complicated LED display. If you use different layers of diode steering combined with switching transistors, you can do very sophisticated arrays of displays. So I encourage you to experiment. And like I said, I'll have these schematics up on my blog, so you can copy them and do your own projects and bend them to your will. Anyway, that's going to do it for this one. I hope you had fun. I know I did. Took me a couple days to throw this together, and I'm glad I did. It was a lot of fun. Hopefully I'll get a chance to, well, I guess I should say, hopefully I'll have an excuse to do more of these kinds of cool projects in the future. All right, I'm Fran. See you next time. Bye.